and it's people that you supped with, cried with, prayed with, hoped with, dreamt with. The pressure begins to build. Come with me to Gethsemane. We read in Luke chapter 22, verse 44, and being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. When the going gets tough, cry out to God. He began to pray more earnestly, and his sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood falling down to the ground. He's beginning to bear the sins of the world on his shoulders. Can you imagine praying that hard that you begin to sweat drops of blood from your forehead? Oh my. During his trial, they came and they took him away at night. During his trial with false accusations, have you been lied about? Have people said things about you that aren't true? There's a lot of pressure with that. I like the scripture in Psalms that says about being, I'm amongst the bulls of Bashan are surrounding me. Sometimes the devil will sow people into your life that they are the bulls of Bashan. You can feel that hot breath on the back of your neck. We see this crescendo building with his scourgings and his beatings and the crown of thorns. And now we come to the crucifixion, and having hung on the cross for 3 hours, he cries out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? It's never wrong to ask God why, as long as you're not questioning his character. Well, what was happening here at this moment is that Jesus was becoming, or had been coming through his passion, the propitiation of our sin.
Right, right.
A holy God demanded that there be wrath poured out upon sin. A holy God demanded that he be appeased because of this sin issue that came into the garden.
Right, right, right.
And in 1 John 2:2, we read that he is the propitiation of our sins.
Praise God.
And not ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world.
Praise God.
In 2 Corinthians, for he hath made him to be sin.
What?
He made him to be the object of God's wrath on sin. That's what's happening. And Jesus had never felt the wrath of God before in his life.
Right, right.
He didn't know what this was. It was unbelievable, tremendous stress and pressure bearing the sins of the world.
Right, right.
He in his body bore our sins on the tree.
Hallelujah. Amen.
He made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of
God
in him. Brother Justin read from Isaiah tonight. I'm going to read from Isaiah also. Let's think about these verses here. Isaiah 53 and verse 3. He is despised and rejected of men. A man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our sorrows, or borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. And look at this next verse. It tells us what's happening here. Who nailed Jesus to the cross? Roman soldiers? Absolutely. Wicked and evil men, the Jewish faith, absolutely. But here's a key in this verse. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. And here it is. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. The peace, to be at peace with God.
Amen.
The chastisement of that peace was borne upon the body of Jesus. And with his stripes we are healed.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
The end of verse 8 says, for the transgression of my people he was stricken. Look down at verse 10. yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He had put him to grief. Who? God did. The Father did. Why did he? Because his holiness demanded that there be an atonement for sin, and that sin had to be reckoned with God's wrath.
Amen.
When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. God will see his son. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. God, says he, God shall see the travail of his soul, and here it is, folks, secured for us, and shall be satisfied by his knowledge. Shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquity.
Praise God.
We, this is what was happening on the cross. Jesus never felt that before. He had never been out of favor with God. He never knew the wrath of God. And that crescendo built, and in this last hour, he cries out as humanity says, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? I have news for you. Jesus got his answer from the Father. It's not recorded, but he got the answer. Thank God. Thank God for Jesus.
Amen.
Isaac Watts wrote, alas, and did my Savior believe me? And did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for such a worm as I? Was it for crimes that I have done? He groaned upon the tree. Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree.
Praise God.
I'll light the sun in darkness hide, and shut his glories in, when Christ the mighty maker died, for man the creature's sin.
Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. Praise
thank God.
God
for Jesus.
Yeah.
Thank God for Jesus.
Yeah.
He fought the battle I could not fight.
Right.
He endured the suffering I could not endure. He paid a debt I could not pay. He paid a debt he did not owe. He faced the wrath of God so that I would not have it. He endured being smitten and stricken of God so that one day, and it's closer now than when I was first saved 40 years ago, one day, not because of anything I've done, but because of the blood of Jesus, I'll stand at the portals of heaven and hear someone say, well done.
Praise
thou good and faithful servant.
Praise God.
Enter thou into the joy of the Lord.
Amen.
And in entering we will cry out, grace, grace, grace. It is the grace of God.
Amen.
May God bless you this evening.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Jesus speaks the fifth words on the cross. At this place called Calvary, the place where we come with our sins and we see a Savior's righteousness. It's where we come with bitterness and we see the sweetness of a Savior. With our despair and we see the Savior's assurance. With our doubt and we see the Savior's life. With our lack of hope and we receive everlasting life. This place called Calvary. The fifth words he says, there's a big responsibility. These are the shortest words. I thirst. So I guess I need to be the shortest tonight, right? And I can do that. I'll try to do that. Even the shortest. Actually, when it comes to English, we get two words out of it. But in the original text, it is just one word. I thirst. What was being said with this word, I thirst, Brother Dismore? There's three things that I want to look at this evening that I believe that Jesus was speaking in that. The very first thing that I think, Sister Sherry, was he was showing us that he was a sympathetic Brother Andrew's Savior. As you already said with his mother, it was showing that he was 100% God, but he was 100% man, Sister Tina. They thought he was a spirit when he came walking across the water. Even after his resurrection, he needed to show them that he was a man. Why did he need to do that? Because it was important.
important to show that I am a sympathetic Savior. Would you imagine with me, Jesus as a small toddler running across, look at Bella and Brenda, they have lots of bruises up and down their legs, and they say, boo-boo daddy, and they have little skins on their knee. I believe Jesus experienced that. He was a sympathetic Savior. I believe that when he was in the carpenter shop, Brother Dennis, he knew what it was like to get a splinter, bang his finger, Brother Val, with a hammer. He knew all about that. He knew what it was like to get hungry. He knew what it was like to be hot. He knew what it was like to be cold. He knew what it was like to even thirst. He was a man. He felt it all, Sister Dismore. It was like the pilot when they were flying, they were on a plane, and all of a sudden they hit turbulence. Boom, 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 boom. The pilot comes on and he says, "Don't need to worry. Just remember, they're just air bumps." I wish I could tell you that all the bumps in the road of life are just air bumps, but they are not. There are real things. Amen. But I need to tell you tonight that we have a Savior that everything you and I experience, amen, he's already gone through. He already experienced it. Scripture, when we look at Scripture, the Bible says that we have a high priest which can be touched with the feelings of our infirmities. Sister Barbara, how does he know? Amen. Because he's been there. He's experienced it. He knows what I'm feeling tonight. Every up and every down. Amen. He knows all about it. Yeah. We hear about it, the passion of Christ. This is the week we look at. What does that passion mean? It means the suffering of our Savior. So he was a sympathetic Savior. The second thing is this. Not only is he a sympathetic Savior and say, "I thirst," but he said, but he is a scriptural Savior. Psalm said that he would be given vinegar to drink. In Psalm 69, Psalms 22, it says about his tongue cleaving to his jaw, or his tongue being to the top of the roof of his mouth. You ever get so thirsty, it seems like you can't even hardly talk, and your tongue stuck to the top of your mouth. I experience it a lot when I'm going with my rounding in the hospital. Lots of people are NPO, or they can't have anything by mouth. They're going to have a test, they're going to have surgery by their mouth. You know all about that. And so, you know, they're there, and they just can't speak. They can't do it because they haven't had any water. It was prophetic that his tongue would be like that. Jesus fulfilled every prophecy. Amen. From his birth to the place of his birth, to the time of his birth, amen, all about his death. I said at Christmas here, for Jesus just to fulfill one prophecy, it would be taking 50-cent pieces and lying them clear across Texas, burying them 2 feet thick, and marking one. Can you imagine? Silver dollars, 2 feet thick, across that big state of Texas, mark one, blindfold someone, send them out to pick that one. That would be what it's like for Jesus to fulfill prophecy. And he fulfilled 322 of Old Testament prophecies. He fulfills Scripture. Though he was misunderstood, amen, though he was mistried, though he was mistaken, he still fulfilled it all. Not only tonight is he a sympathetic Savior, and he's a scriptural Savior, but I find that he is a sufficient Savior.
Yeah.
What does this mean by he's so thirsty? Amen. He's thirsty. Brother David, you hit the nail on the head. It was physical. It was emotional. It was spiritual. Here he is. He's been 3 hours in the darkness, Sister Dismore. We find that he takes upon him the sins of the world. Sister Sherry, the Father turns his back. And so, Brother Craig, there he is, separated from his Father. If you would tonight, that was hell. That was hell. May I remind you of the rich man and Lazarus, how bad hell is, that the rich man said, "Send Lazarus, that he may dip his finger in water and put it on my tongue. I am thirsty." Jesus experienced thirst, that our thirst may be quenched. Amen. I thirst, that I may provide. Amen. Water and water everlasting. Amen. He is a sufficient Savior. Amen. Heaven says, the Word of God says in Revelation 7, verse number 16 about heaven. Amen. Neither do they thirst anymore. Amen. Revelation 22, 17. Take of the water of life freely. Do you know why he thirsts, Sister Tina? So we wouldn't have to. Amen. I thirst so that I can be a sufficient.
life. There it was at the crossroads. The Samaritan woman come. He said, I'm thirsty. I need to stay. He was man. Amen. He was God, though. And he told her, he said, I'm going to give you water to drink that you've never drank before. But the well is deep. How are you going to get it? And he begins to say to her about her five husbands. And the one that she's with now is her husband. Well, how do you know all that? Because you're looking for something. You're thirsty. I want to give it to you. And he gave her water. Do you know what? The well is deep, Brother Dennis. I don't have access on my own to get to it. Then because he thirsts. Amen. Because he went through hell, he gave me heaven that my thirst may be quenched, and so is yours. Amen. Tonight I want you to know that we have a sympathetic Savior. Amen. He was God, but he was man. Everything that we'll ever go through, he's been there. We can touch him with the feelings of our infirmity.
Amen.
We have a scriptural Savior. Amen. Everything throughout the Word of God, Old Testament, New Testament, he is God.
Yes.
But we also have. If you're thirsty tonight, amen, there's still water for you. And I want to tell you, one day we're going to drink free. Amen. At the place, amen, where the water is sweeter than we've ever experienced before. Brother Jeff, come.
God's here to help us.
Amen.
John chapter 19, verse 30. Amen. Amen. When Jesus, therefore, had received the vinegar, amen, fulfilling those Old Testament prophets,
yes,
amen, he said, it is finished.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Thank you.
And he bowed his head. He gave up the ghost.
Yes, praise the Lord.
It was over.
Thank you, Lord.
It's done.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Victory.
Oh, praise the Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
This was all coming up, and he fulfilled everything, all these wonderful things. He fulfilled it. It is finished.
Hallelujah.
The work of salvation was finished.
Amen.
Hey, I'd like to just give us a few scriptures here tonight, amen, about what he did. Galatians 3, 13 and 14, Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law.
Right.
The law, all it did was show us how cursed we were.
Right.
We had sinned. We've all sinned.
Right.
The Bible says that from the womb we go forth telling lies.
Right.
The Bible says that we're sinners, and the law, all it could do was tell us how bad we are. The world needs to know that. A lot of people think they're okay, but they're lost. They're under the curse. Brother Fiddler talked about repentance. It's so important. Amen. But Jesus paid the price.
Amen.
So that we are not cursed anymore if we come to him. Amen. For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree. He hung. He hung. He was cursed for me.
Amen.
He was cursed for you.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Tonight we as Christians are not cursed anymore.
Yes.
Because he took our curse.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Amen. That the blessing of Abraham, oh, it was finished. Listen, might come upon, let me read it right, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith.
Yes.
Did you know that the promise of the Father was given all that time? And because it's finished, you can be baptized in the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Hallelujah. We receive the Spirit of salvation, but we can also have the baptism. Do I deserve it? Do we deserve it? This baptism in the Holy Ghost is by faith, by grace. Hallelujah, just a salvation. We are not cursed anymore. Amen. Now think about this. A few verses in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 13. It says this, but now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. He said, it is finished. Listen, today you and I can come into the very presence of the throne room of God because of the blood of Jesus. I couldn't come there before. If you're not saying you can't go, but if you will come to the cross, if you will come to the cross of Jesus Christ, you will be able to go into the very throne room of heaven. What a wonderful thing, just by faith. Hallelujah. Jump down to verse 16. It says that he might, hallelujah, that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby, the Gentiles, the Jews, the black, the white, whatever the races, whatever the rich and the poor, God has brought us that we can love one another, we can forgive one another, we can have fellowship with one another. Hallelujah, that we were enemies of God, but now we are made friends with God. How can that be? You think of the things that I've done. You think of the things that we've done. But through the cross, through the blood, we are now in the presence of Almighty God because it is finished. Hallelujah. Go on down to verse 18. For through him we both have access by one Spirit unto the Father. Through him. Oh, it's a wonderful thing. Hallelujah. Have you ever prayed? Have you ever felt his presence? We have felt it tonight. It's because of the finished work of Jesus tonight. Not because I've been perfect. Not because, I grew up in a preacher's home, but I had to go to an altar of prayer at the age of 6 years of age in a revival meeting. Praise the Lord. The first time in my life, amen, I realized that I was lost. God brought me into the family of God. Hallelujah. We have access. We have access, praise the Lord. Colossians 2:14 and 15, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us. Amen. And took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. All those Old Testament ceremonies. Oh, I'm glad we don't have to come and offer an animal every church service. I'm glad we don't have to all the other things that they have there. But they were all nailed to his cross. Amen. So that we can live for God. So that we can walk in freedom. You go on down there. It says here, it says in having. Amen. Repeat. I got to bring this up so I can see. Amen. And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them. I tell you what, those ceremonial things were done away. But listen, brothers and sisters, Satan has been nailed to the cross also. He's been defeated in the name of Jesus. He said, my children, hey, those that believe will cast out devils. Amen. He's been nailed in the name of Jesus. Cast him out. In the name of Jesus, rebuke him. In the name of Jesus, tell him to leave because it was finished. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Oh, praise God. Listen, the devil doesn't have to torment you anymore. The devil, because he has been nailed. Oh, praise the Lord. He destroyed principalities and powers. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hebrews 2:14, for as much then as the children of Brother Seville brought our partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death. You don't have to be afraid of death tonight. Hey, amen. Just as a brother talked about, when we're going to go to be with him when we die. If we die tonight, we're going to go to be with Jesus. He destroyed him that had the power of death. Praise the Lord. Amen. Oh, that is the devil. And deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. You don't have to live in fear tonight because it's finished. Hallelujah. Praise God. You think about it. You're gonna see Jesus someday. Hallelujah. Oh, praise the Lord. Two more verses here tonight. 1 Peter 2:24. Who his own self bare our sins in his own blood body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness. Hallelujah. Listen, you see, the ceremonies are gone, but we can live right. You can live right because he bore that on the cross. You can live a holy life. You can live for Jesus. You can live pleasing to him. You can walk with him. Hallelujah. Because he bore on the cross. Hallelujah. Oh, I'm just here to tell you tonight, by whose stripes he were healed. Amen. It's finished. It's finished. Every sickness is finished. Hallelujah. Jesus paid for it. It is done. Every stripe, every drop of blood. Oh, praise the Lord. It is finished. Hallelujah. Oh, I tell you what, by grace today, you ever claim victory? Hey, hallelujah. It's through the blood. It's through his stripes. There are times of sickness. There are times of sometimes I'm horribly sick. But you begin to plead the blood. You begin to plead his stripes. You begin to plead his grace. And Jesus paid my healing. Hallelujah. First John 3:8. Amen. He that committeth sin is of the devil. For the devil sinneth from the beginning. That's what we were from the time we were born until we were saved. Hallelujah. Oh, somebody said, man, I got such a bad habit. You talk about alcohol. You talk about all kinds of sins. Things that get people into addiction. But listen to this. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested that he might destroy the works of the devil. Did you know, hallelujah, your sickness can be destroyed because he came to destroy the works of the devil? Hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus can set you free. Jesus can heal your body. Jesus can deliver you from sin. Hallelujah, it is finished.
Hallelujah.
Now we come to the end of his ordeal on the cross. We read in the scriptures, just a moment to get there. Luke chapter 23 and verse 46. And Jesus cried out with a loud voice. He said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And having said thus, gave up the ghost. First saying, he said, Father. And in the last saying, he said, Father, also. This is really Psalm 31 and verse 5. It was a prayer that every Jewish mother in Jesus' day taught her children to pray at night. It was the last thing they would say. They would say, into thy hand, I commit my spirit. When I was a young boy, I had an Aunt Margie, my mother's sister. I love Margie. She was a little practical. She was a piece of work, but she was our piece of work. But one night, I was spending the night. Now I'm 55 years old, going on 56 in the fall. So this must be 51 or 52 years ago. We went to the upstairs bedroom. My cousins, her daughters were 8 and 9 years older than me, and for some reason, Gail was not home that night, and I was going to sleep that night in Gail's bedroom. And I'm happy to say that even though it was a canopy bed, I struggled with nothing in my life because of that, all right? But I remember she said, now let's say our prayers, and she said, say with me now, lady. Now I lay me down to sleep. We got to the end, and if I should die before I wake, I froze. She had a Bible in her house. She went to Sunday school every week. We did too, but we missed a few. She did. And I said to her, am I going to die tonight? And she said, no. And I thought, oh, I don't know. Now, can you imagine how overjoyed a four-year-old was when he felt the morning sun come in through the window? God kept me all that night in that great big lonely room.